Hello, I am Dr. Aizaz from MedicoVisual.com back with another visual lecture on the topic of diagnosis of COVID-19. In this lecture, I will talk about that how we diagnose coronavirus disease, COVID-19, what is the role of PCR in diagnosis, and we will also talk about the radiographic findings in the atypical pneumonia caused by this disease. In the end, we will also talk about some non-specific findings and we will correlate it with the pathological problems that incur in this disease, right? So we will start that how we will diagnose. So basically on history, we will see that there should be a history of travel to epidemic area. Although it is not necessary because there also may be the history of close contact with suspected or infected patient. Right, so along with that, there must be some symptoms, one or more symptoms of coronavirus, such as there may be symptoms of fever, malaise, body aches, and the headache and shortness of breath. So all of these symptoms and these complex of symptomatology, they will raise our suspicion for diagnosis of COVID-19. Right, so how can we diagnose it? You know, as you know, I have told you previously that coronavirus, the SARS coronavirus type 2, it loves to infect type 2 alveolar pneumocytes, right, which are present in lower respiratory tract. So it is a disease of lower respiratory tract. Now what we do is that we can use a bronchoscope, and this bronchoscope is inserted, and with that we will squirt some fluid into bronchi and alveoli, and then we can bring back this fluid, right? And of course in infected patient, this fluid will be rich in coronavirus particles, right? And this process is called, this method is called bronchoalveolar lavage, right? But the problem with this procedure is that this procedure, although it can take out sample easily and coronavirus particles will be there, but the problem is that we need special equipment for this. We need bronchoscope, we need special preparations for this. We need special staff for this. We need a pulmonologist who will come and do this procedure, and it is also inconvenient for patient. So it is not routinely done, right? There is another method which is much more convenient but slightly less sensitive. You know, these virus particles, coronavirus particles, although it is of low respiratory tract origin, but they can be present in nasopharynx or oropharynx. Especially when patient coughs up, these particles, they may be inoculated here in nasopharynx and oropharynx. So we can take out a sample from nasopharynx and oropharynx, and that can be used for sampling, right? Okay, so what we do is that there is a stick with a cotton swab or some sterile cotton swab or polyester attached with it, right? And we will insert this into nasopharynx, and we will remove the particles here. We can take a sample from nasopharynx or oropharynx, right? We can insert it from nose or we can insert it from mouth. So it could be nasopharyngeal swab or oropharyngeal swab, right? So sample can be taken by bronchoalveolar lavage or by nasopharyngeal or oropharyngeal swab, right? But of course, you know, this method is less convenient but more accurate, but this method is more convenient but less accurate, right? So let's move forward. So now that we have got the sample, we have got coronavirus particles from the patient of this disease, right? Now what we will do? So we cannot directly see these particles, right? And we have to extract the viral RNA. By certain molecular techniques, we will extract the RNA of virus and we will remove and discard everything else, right? So we have extracted these. I will not tell you the details of those techniques. Now that we have extracted the viral RNA, now the problem again here is that this RNA, we cannot see this RNA with our eyes, right? So what can we do? We cannot even see them with microscope. These are very small particle, molecular things, right? We cannot see them even with microscope. So we have to make lots and lots of copies of this RNA, right? And these copies can then be detected through certain techniques. Now the problem here is that we cannot make copies of RNA, we cannot further manipulate the RNA because it is very unstable. We have to somehow convert this RNA. I am showing just one RNA here for the sake of simplicity. We have to convert this RNA into DNA, right? Normally, from DNA we make in our body, from DNA we make RNA, and this process is called transcription. But now we want to make DNA from RNA. It is opposite of transcription. It is called reverse transcription. And for this, this is the viral RNA. For this process, we need an enzyme which does the process of reverse transcription. So this enzyme is named as reverse transcriptase. Yes, rightly said. So reverse transcriptase will come and it will form a complementary copy of DNA in front of this RNA. This DNA which is formed must be complementary to this RNA, so we call it cDNA or complementary DNA, right? Now this enzyme, and now that we have got this DNA, RNA is of no use right now, so we will remove this RNA. We will use some RNAs that will eat up this RNA. Now we have got only DNA. This is single-stranded DNA. We have to make double-stranded DNA, and for that, of course, again reverse transcriptase will come into play. This reverse transcriptase also has DNA polymerase activity, so it will form a complementary copy in front of it. Now we have double-stranded DNA. So with this double-stranded DNA, we can amplify this double-stranded DNA. We can make lots and lots of copies of this double-stranded DNA. Okay, so what we are gonna do? First of all, we will heat it so that these strands are separated. By the way, why we are amplifying the DNA? Do you know?
We cannot detect.
We cannot detect one or two copies of DNA. Let's suppose the infection is in very early stage in the patient. So in that case, there will be very few particles of DNA, very few particles of virus in the patient. So even at that stage with PCR, we can detect that because it will make millions of copies of RNA which can be detected. So now these two strands are separated. Now we need this enzyme DNA polymerase. We need DNA polymerase enzyme. The DNA polymerase enzyme, it is an arrogant enzyme. That's what I like to call it. Why it is arrogant enzyme? Because it will not initiate the reaction. It will not initiate the copying of DNA. Its demand is that it need a 20 to 30 nucleotide sequence present over here and over here, and it will elongate that sequence. Right, so it will elongate that sequence. It cannot initiate the reaction. It is a limitation. It's a biochemical limitation of this enzyme. So what we will do? We need a initial sequence, and the sequence which is required to prime the reaction, that is called primer. Primer is 20 to 30 nucleotide sequence. Now we do not target the whole RNA. We don't target the whole RNA of, rather here is complementary DNA, whole complementary DNA of coronavirus. We target one or two genes. For example, we may target nucleocapsid gene or N gene, right? So we will target that gene, and for that we have primers. Primers are, as you know, 20 to 30 nucleotide sequence that are specific for a particular gene. One primer will come and attach here at this end, at one end, and other primer will attach at other end of N gene of coronavirus. It is specific for that, right? Let's suppose if here is A, then here must be T, right? If here is G, here must be C, right? So it is like that. So Yeah, he's asking in case of RNA, it must be you because, but we don't have RNA, my friend.
Primers?
No, primer is not RNA. Whole this thing is not DNA. Remember, during reverse transcriptase, with the help of reverse transcriptase, we converted whole thing into DNA. No, this is not RNA, this is DNA, right? You got the answer? So, primer will attach at this specific position. Now, what if this patient is not infected with coronavirus? Let's suppose this patient is infected with influenza virus. Let's suppose here is DNA of influenza virus or complementary DNA of influenza virus. Now, if we add the primer of coronavirus, of course, it won't be specific for this influenza virus. Will it be able to attach here? Of course not. So, can the reaction proceed forward? No. So here, we can not only detect the presence of coronavirus, we can also ascertain that it is actually coronavirus and not some other virus due to specific nature of primer. You got the point? So now that because it is specific, so primer has, unfortunately, this patient was infected with coronavirus. So because of that, the primer has now attached with this N gene of coronavirus, right? Now what will happen? This arrogant DNA polymerase will come and it will elongate the chain. It will extend the chain, right? So it has made a copy and it will also extend this chain, right? So now we have got how many DNA from one DNA, one double-stranded DNA molecule, we have got two. We have got two double-stranded DNA molecules. Are you getting the point? So in this way, from one we can get two copies, and from these two further we can get more two copies, and then here also two more copies. And in this way, a chain reaction ensues, right? From one, we will get two. From two, we will get four. From four, we will get how many? Eight copies. So this chain reaction that is mediated by polymerase, DNA polymerase enzyme, that chain reaction is ensued, right? So this chain reaction is called polymerase mediated chain reaction, or simply polymerase chain reaction, right? But here is one thing, that it is not simply PCR or polymerase chain reaction. We have also utilized reverse transcriptase enzyme here. So this is called reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction. For DNA viruses, only PCR or polymerase chain reaction is enough to diagnose. But for RNA viruses, their RNA must first be converted into DNA. So that is, we need reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction, and full name is it stands for RT-PCR. The acronym is RT-PCR, right? Now that we have got, and in this way we will form millions of copies of N gene of coronavirus, right? Now how can we now detect that coronavirus is present? Very simple. Now all these copies which we have got, we will insert them, we will load them on a special gel called agarose gel. So here are those copies which are loaded on agarose gel. Now this agarose gel, it is connected with positive and negative electrode. Let's suppose here battery is inserted, right? And it is connected with negative and positive electrodes. And when current will pass, all these particles will form a single band. Why so? Because DNA is negatively charged, right? DNA is negatively charged due to presence of phosphate. You know, DNA is consisting of phosphate, PO4 negative, right? So due to that, it will move towards positive electrode. Negative charge will move towards positive electrode. But because all of these are amplified from a single gene, all of these DNA molecules are of same size, so they will form a single band. They will be aggregated at a single place, at a single band. So a single band will be there, and this presence of a band indicates that there must be DNA molecule there. It means that PCR reaction has proceeded and it indicates the presence of virus. It indicates the presence of virus. Suppose if virus was not there, coronavirus was not there, maybe it was influenza virus or no virus at all. What will happen? There will be no band at all, right? So now that we have detected that coronavirus is present there. But in this case, we cannot quantify that how much coronavirus is present, how many particles of coronavirus is present, what is the viral load of coronavirus, right? So polymerase chain reaction that is mediated by reverse transcriptase or RT-PCR. Now there is a workaround of this process. There is a workaround with which we can detect the viral load of coronavirus. How can we do so? We can add a fluorescent molecule. We can add some fluorescent molecules, and these fluorescent molecules are molecularly designed in such a way that they can only bind with double-stranded DNA molecule. So let's suppose a number of fluorescent molecules are added into this machine, but they will not lighten up. They will only lighten up, they will only emit fluorescence when they are attached with double-stranded DNA, right? So there is initially one double-stranded DNA, a fluorescent molecule will attach with it and it will lighten up, right? And we can detect fluorescence with some computer techniques, computer mediated techniques. Then it will, two copies will be made and fluorescence will gradually increase as the reaction proceeds. And of course reaction proceeds exponentially, so fluorescence also increases exponentially with number of cycles, right? So let's suppose if we form a graph, so fluorescence will exponentially increase, right? So here is the time, right? And here is fluorescence, right? Now here there is something called threshold of detection of fluorescence. We can only detect fluorescence at a certain level. Let's suppose if 8 molecules of fluorescence are activated, only then we can detect it. So here we have 8 molecules of fluorescence or 8 molecules of DNA. It can only be detected when such number is present. So this is the threshold, right? Now imagine two situations. In one situation, the patient only had one particle. Of course, it is not hypothetically possible. I am just assuming. Let's suppose that patient has only single particle of coronavirus. In this case, it will undergo first cycle to form 2 molecules, then another cycle to form 4 molecules, then another cycle of PCR to form 8 molecules, and then it will be detected, right? So in this case, when one particle was there, we are able to detect after 1, 2, and 3 cycles. But let's suppose initially the patient had 4 molecules of coronavirus. So in the sample, so now we only after a single cycle, now we will be able to detect it, right? Threshold will be achieved in only a single cycle, only after a single cycle. So because of this, we can mathematically calculate that how quickly threshold is achieved, that how much quickly with how much number of cycle threshold is achieved, we can estimate the viral load. Are you getting the point? That if with very less number of cycles, or if very quickly threshold is achieved, it means that we have initially very large number of coronavirus particles in the sample. But if threshold is achieved after a long time, if threshold is achieved, it means initially in the sample there were very small number of coronavirus particles. So in this way we can quantify the coronavirus particles. In this way we can quantify viral load.
Is there some mathematical calculation?
Yeah, there is a mathematical formula. I am not gonna tell you. There is some graphs. Graphs are plotted in real time. In real time, such graphs are plotted as I have shown you. and with that there is some certain mathematical formulas with that we can calculate it, right? So this is polymerase chain reaction, and it is also mediated by reverse transcriptase, but it is real-time polymerase chain reaction because fluorescence is plotted graphically by computer in real time, opposite to the traditional PCR that is also called endpoint PCR, because as the PCR ends, then we put it into agarose gel and detect it, and that cannot quantify it. So that traditional one is called qualitative PCR and this one is called quantitative PCR. Other name of it is reverse transcriptase quantitative polymerase chain reaction, or we also call it RT-qpcr. Q stands for quantitative, right?
So what are the differences between qualitative and
so by now you must must have a clear knowledge that what is the difference. Very simple. So let's summarize what are the difference is that it can detect the let me tell you what is the role in diagnosis and treatment. Well, in diagnosis it can be simply detected by simple RT-PCR. Presence of virus can be detected by RT-PCR. We will get yes or no answer. If band is there, it means yes, virus is there. If band is not there, then it is diagnosis is no, right? According to PCR. Of course, later on I will tell you that it is not very much sensitive. Sometime this test may be negative and patient may have the symptom or disease. Patient may have that disease. Then I will tell you what we will do. But it just gives the answer in yes or no. We cannot quantify the virus. But here, let's suppose we are giving treatment to patient. So we can check the response of treatment with qPCR. Initially viral load was, let's say, 2000. And after we are giving certain treatment to patient, now that viral load may have decreased to, let's say, 100. It means our treatment has become quite successful. With simple PCR, we cannot check the prognosis of disease. We cannot check the response to treatment. So that is better in such circumstances. But for simple yes or no answer, RT-PCR is enough. It is enough. And that is cheaper method. That is less expensive. This is more expensive, right? And another point, rather than fluorescence, we can also use certain probes here. There are certain specific probes. I am not gonna tell you the details. That is quite complex and beyond the scope of this lecture. Right now, I will just stick to this method, right? So let's move forward. Now, here I will tell you what is the role of X-ray and how X-ray work. So let's suppose this is an X-ray film, right? And here is the X-ray source. So here is the patient. Now, X-ray source, as we press the X-ray button, X-ray source will emit X-ray radiations, and these radiations will pass through the body of patient, right? And on the film, those if radiation they pass through without any obstruction from the body, those parts of the body which do not obstruct the path of X-ray, they will lead to black thing on this X-ray film. But anything which obstruct the path of this X-ray, let's suppose bones may be present here, right? The rib bones, they may obstruct the path of these X-rays. So because they are dense. So when they obstruct the path, it will lead to formation of whitish structure. And that is what we call it radiopaque substance. So white things on X-ray mean that path of X-ray is obstructed by that substance. And black thing means that path is not obstructed. Now here I will tell you something, that on our lungs, they are filled with air. Okay, our lungs are filled with air, and alveoli, they are very thinned wall. They are radiolucent. They allow the X-rays to pass through it. So they will be black or white on X-ray film?
Black.
They will be black, obviously. But in coronavirus disease, what happens that, let me tell you something. In coronavirus disease, what happens in atypical pneumonia caused by coronavirus, what will happen that, this is your lung and this is a single alveoli, right? What will happen that inflammatory cell will come here and they will damage this interstitial space, right? So due to presence of inflammation, there are certain patches of inflammation. Due to presence of these inflammatory cells, right, what will happen that on X-ray, there will be such shadows that it will appear as a haze. It will appear as some ground particles of glass that are thrown on X-ray film, right? I will show you how it will look like. And also there may be, especially in later stages, these alveoli will be filled with fluid. Yeah, pus. It will be filled with fluid and it will lead to formation of what we call it consolidation, right? So here is the X-ray and you can see these patches of inflammation, these ground glass haziness thing, right? You can see here, right? Are you getting the point? And consolidation may be there. I think there is no consolidation in this X-ray, but it may be there, especially in later stages. Ground glass appearance and consolidation. Now, what is CT scan? CT scan is basically a CT scan machine. What it does is that it takes a number of X-rays of a patient from various angles, from various views. It takes number of X-rays of the patient and then it combines those images digitally with the help of computer. It combines the image and we can get cross sections, right? We can get cross sections on the film, right? We can get cross section. So here it is, the CT scan of patient. Okay. So here also on CT scan, we can more clearly see the haziness or ground glass appearance. Now, interesting thing about CT scan, it is very sensitive. It is more sensitive than PCR. And of course, it is more sensitive than X-ray. But it is not specific for COVID-19. Any atypical pneumonia will have similar features. Interestingly, this diagram, this X-ray and CT scan is of pulmonary candidiasis. It is not of coronavirus. Actually, I was searching a picture for coronavirus, but I could not find a copyright-free picture of that CT scan or X-ray. You can find them on Radiopedia if you want to understand more, right? So it is not specific for that. Any atypical pneumonia or any viral pneumonia can present with such features. But it is much more sensitive. What they have observed is that in certain patients in which they done the PCR, and sometimes PCR result is negative, especially in early stage, and when it is not taken with the sample is not taken from bronchoalveolar lavage, that was taken from nasopharyngeal swab. But doctors had a strong suspicion of this disease. So they done CT scan, and in CT scan such findings were there. So they came to know that CT scan is more sensitive, but it is not advised to be done routinely because CT scan exposes the patient to lots and lots of X-ray radiation, which are harmful for the patient. So routinely it should not be done, but it can be done if suspicion is high and PCR test is negative, right? So you got the point? Okay, so let's move forward. Of course, CT scan, it is sensitive, but not specific. Now, there are certain non-specific findings in the patient of coronavirus that we will now discuss. So let's suppose this is a lung of a patient, not a single lung, both lungs of a patient of coronavirus. And here I am representing the vascular system, blood vasculature of whole body of coronavirus patient. Of course, you know, in blood vessel, there are many things. And one of those things is immune cells, mainly lymphocytes are present. Now, when coronavirus particles are infecting here due to interleukins and other chemical messenger, they will recruit lymphocyte. They will recruit lymphocyte to lungs. So lots of lymphocytes will be recruited to lungs and they will be sequestered there because fight is going on, war is going on inside the lung. So they will sequestered there. So because of that, in blood, relatively what you will see that number of lymphocyte has decreased. Number of lymphocytes has decreased in blood relatively because they are sequestered into what? Into lungs, right? this is the not the only reason. What they have found is that these coronavirus, they have direct toxic effect. They have direct cytotoxic effect on these immune cells. They can directly infect and kill these immune cells. So because of two reasons, these two reasons, lymphocytopenia may be there. Of course, these are not the only two reasons. There are certain other theories or hypotheses to explain the hematological changes in this disease. I'm not gonna go into details. If you want to know more, you can study them on Google Scholar. There are certain research articles, peer-reviewed articles, in which they have explained the reason of hematological reason, hematological theories, right? So when lymphocyte will decrease, and because virus is infecting, so and interleukins will be released, some of the interleukins, they will stimulate this bone marrow of the patient, and bone marrow will release, they will form and release more and more lymphocyte, more and more white blood cell into blood. So sometimes white blood cell may even increase. So mainly in coronavirus patient, it is, I think 70 to 80% cases, it is lymphocytopenia. But in 20-30 patient, there may also be lymphocytosis. These both are not specific features of coronavirus, but they may raise the suspicion, right? Now here I will tell you some other things. When there is immune-mediated damage and virus-mediated damage to endothelial cell may be damaged. And you know, when endothelial cell are damaged, what will happen? What will happen that these, due to endothelial cell damage, platelets will come and they will love to stick these damaged endothelial cells. So when lots and lots of platelets will come and they will form clots here, it will further worsen the situation. Along with that, in blood, thrombocytopenia may occur. Right? Thrombocytopenia may also occur. So this is another feature of COVID-19. Right? So here I'm gonna tell you the role of interleukin 6. So macrophages and other immune cells, when they are fighting with coronavirus, they will secrete chemical messenger, that is interleukin 6 will be secreted by them. They secrete number of cytokines and interleukins. One of them is interleukin 6. Interleukin 6, it will go to liver. And from hepatocyte, it will cause release of C-reactive protein. It will release certain proteins called C-reactive proteins. What these C-reactive proteins will do is that they will attach with dead cell. Let's suppose this is a dead cell. And it will attach with this dead cell. This is C-reactive protein attaching with dead cell. And as it will attach with dead cell, what it will do is that there is something called complement system. I won't tell you the detail. So it will cause activation of complement pathway. And when complement pathway will active, when it is tagged by C-reactive protein, complement pathway will be active, and phagocytic cell will quickly come and eat up this dead cell. You are getting the point? Look at the beauty of this system. So it is like a burial cloth, the shroud or burial cloth that is put upon the dead cell. But we don't have a graveyard to bury these cells. What we do is that we recycle these dead cells, and these dead cells will be recycled by phagocytic cells. Thank God that this mechanism exists. Otherwise, our body up till now, it would be full of pus, because daily we encounter millions of pathogens. So such beautiful mechanism exists in nature. Right? So you are getting the point. This C in C-reactive protein, what does this C mean in C-reactive protein?
From complementary
part. Yeah, because it is activating complement pathway. So it is called C-reactive protein or C-activating, complement activating protein. So it is called C-reactive protein, right? So we can measure the levels of C-reactive protein in blood. If we take a sample here in lab, we can measure it, and it is a non-specific indicator of inflammation. Any inflammation can lead to increase in C-reactive protein. So that is one of non-specific finding in coronavirus disease, right? So C-reactive protein. Now here I will tell you the something called cytokine storm. You know what happens as the fight is going on here? Let's suppose this is a blood vessel. Immune cell will release lots and lots of cytokines. What these cytokines will do locally, these cytokines will cause vasodilation and increase vascular permeability. It will increase vascular permeability. What is the benefit of this? Can you tell me what is the benefit of this?
Neutrophils will come.
Yeah. Due to this vascular permeability, increased vascular permeability, it will cause more and more immune cell. It will recruit more and more immune cells into this area, into this war zone, right? So that body quickly gets rid of this enemy that has entered into lung. But sometime when lots and lots of cytokines are produced here, which were causing mainly local effect, they may spill over into systemic circulation. And now, in systemic circulation, what they will do? In systemic circulation, they will cause such effects. What were those effects? Increased vascular permeability and vasodilation. So lots and lots of cytokines in systemic circulation, this is called cytokine storm, they will increase vascular permeability and vasodilation will be there, and they will decrease blood pressure. They may lead to shock, septicemic shock, right? They will lead to shock, and it is called systemic inflammatory response syndrome, right? Also, these cytokines, here another thing, these cytokines will also go on to, these are like alarm system of our body. They will go on and they will give a message to different organs of our body that something dangerous is gonna come, be prepared for it. It will give a message that let's prepare for this impounding foyer here. So these other cells, these other tissues of our body, they will start to recruit macrophages, they will start to recruit lymphocytes, they will start activating macrophages. These macrophages will also generate, they will also get their weapons ready. They will generate lots and lots of reactive oxygen species so as to kill the organism that will come. But this can be a problem. When organism is not there, the virus is not here, what will happen? That due to presence of these reactive oxygen species, they may even cause damage to normal cells, let's suppose normal cells of liver. Also, because due to vasodilation and due to decreased blood pressure, blood flow to different organs will decrease. Blood flow to liver will decrease, blood flow to kidney will decrease, right? So because of these immune mediated damage and because of decreased blood flow, damage to these organs will also occur, right? Multi organ failure might occur, right? For example, in liver is made up of hepatocytes. Let's suppose this is a single hepatocyte. These hepatocytes are cute little chemists. They are involved in metabolism of lots of substances, and one of that is amino acids. They have certain enzymes called aminotransferase enzymes. Aminotransferase enzymes, let's suppose these are present here, and aminotransferase enzymes, these are involved in amino acid metabolism. So when hepatocytes injury will occur, these enzymes, they will spill over into systemic circulation, right? So these aminotransferases, these are called AST and ALT, aspartate transaminase and alanine transaminase. They will spill over into blood. So they will be raised in plasma and we can detect it in lab. So LFTs might be deranged in this case, right? Especially in later stages when complications start to occur, right? Also, our kidneys, they are one of their responsibility. There are many functions of kidney. One of their responsibility is to get rid of urea and creatinine, which are our waste products. So when kidney damage will occur, what will happen? Urea and creatinine will raised. Urea and creatinine will be raised, right? And when myocardial damage will occur, sometime damage to heart may occur, myocardial tissue may occur, it will lead to raised troponins, right? So are you clear up to now? So let's move forward. Here another thing. You know what happens normally, most of our cells, we metabolize what? Glucose. Right? We metabolize glucose. From glucose, through the process of glycolysis, multi-step pathway, we form pyruvate. Right? Now this pyruvate, it may go into mitochondria, right? And it undergo TCA cycle. Right? But in those cells, in which mitochondria is not present, for example, RBC, or even in normal cell, when oxygen tension is low, because TCA cycle requires oxygen, when oxygen tension is low, pyruvate may be converted into lactate. This is anaerobic respiration. Pyruvate may be converted into lactate, right? And this is a reversible reaction. Lactate then may convert back into pyruvate, and this reaction is mediated by an enzyme called lactate dehydrogenase. Sometimes, let's suppose this cell, when it gets damaged, this LDH, it may comes out into blood and it may spill over into circulation, right? So raised LDH, because LDH is present in most of the cell, so raised LDH indicates a cellular injury, but it is non-specific cellular injury. So when LDH is raised, we know that there must be some cellular injury, but we cannot ascertain that which cell, which kind of tissue cell has been damaged. So LDH might be raised because multi-organ failure may occur and multiple tissues are being damaged. Even due to damage to lung tissues, LDH may be raised. So it is one of a non-specific finding in COVID-19, right? So let's summarize what we have read. Till now, do you have any question up till now? Okay, so let's summarize investigations of COVID-19. Specific investigation, RT-PCR. By RT-PCR, I mean? No, my friend, it is not real time. It is reverse transcriptase. Yeah, there is actually in old literature, they used to write it RT for real time. So it caused confusion. So then scientists agreed that we should not use RT for real time. We should reserve it for reverse transcriptase. What they did is that they started using Q, the term small q, for quantitative or real time PCR. So qualitative or quantitative or qRT-PCR, right? So you know what is the difference between them. I don't need to repeat here, right? Radiological investigation will be X-ray and CT scanned, and on that there must be ground glass appearance, and later on consolidation might be there, or they may go hand in hand. And non-specific on CBC, complete blood count, there may be lymphocytopenia or lymphocytosis. Lymphocytopenia means decrease in lymphocyte, and lymphocytosis means increase in lymphocytes, right? So it is not only lymphocytopenia, it can be leukocytopenia. I mean generally all WBCs may be low, all leukocytosis, all leukocytes may be raised, right? Actually, this is DLC finding, differential leukocyte finding. It is not CBC finding. I have wrongly mentioned here, sorry about that. And on CBC, there may be decreased platelet count, thrombocytopenia may be there. other non-specific finding is C-reactive protein, right? And LDH may be raised. Liver damage due to liver damage, AST, ALT may be raised. Due to kidney damage, urea creatinine may be raised, and troponin might be raised in myocardial injury, right? So this was about investigation of coronavirus disease. Everything clear?
Yes.
Okay. What I have noticed is that lots of misinformation is being spread, even by educated people. This is sad to know. Please don't do this. It is very dangerous. Only trust the authoritative sources, such as FDA, CDC, WHO, these websites, and some peer-reviewed research articles and some authoritative books. Don't just spread everything that you see on social media. Prevention is nicely explained on WHO and CDC websites. Please have a look on that. I will share the link in description. Regarding the treatment, up till now, there is no 100% proven treatment for this COVID-19. They are getting good results from the chloroquine, the anti-malarial drug, and some protease inhibitors as well. Nothing is confirmed yet, so I might update you later with these things, right? All those people who are supporting me, who are liking, sharing, and subscribing my channel, I can't thank you enough. Thank you so much for your support. These videos were mainly intended for medical students and healthcare professionals. But I am very glad and surprised to know that non-medical people, they are also able to understand it. Another thing I want to talk about here is that some people, although there are very few, they are disliking my videos. Well, you are entitled to your opinion. You are welcome to dislike, but please at least mention the reason for disliking. I put lots and lots of effort into creating these videos. I literally study hundreds of sources, different books, different research articles to come up with these videos. So just pressing the dislike button, it doesn't do any good. If you want to dislike, at least mention the reason so that I can improve myself, right? Thank you for watching the video. Please like, share, and subscribe. And also please give your precious comments about the video. Thank you.